In December 2023, an Iranian drone flying over the Persian Gulf was able to get close enough to the Eisenhower carrier strike group to record their movements, including their flight deck operations. To the uninformed, it seems alarming that the Navy's air defense was so easily infiltrated by a cheap drone. The thing is, letting the drone fly above the aircraft carrier wasn't a failure. It was a choice. The SPY-1 radar can easily see dirt in the sky, so the ships would have detected that Iranian drone from miles away. And they proved it by publishing this photo to show who's really in charge. But why not shoot down this pesky drone? Well, the American warship was sailing in international waters, and the Iranian drone was flying in international airspace. Both are allowed. I bet the CIWS was locked on and salivating. But that would have been the very last line of defense. If instead this was an anti-ship missile coming toward the carrier, it would have been a much more interesting scenario. Because even though an aircraft carrier is a beast of a ship and carries an air force that dwarfs that of most other nations, it cannot survive on its own. It in fact relies on a combination of support ships in order to defend itself. And once you see how this multi-layered defense works, you'd seriously question the sanity of those who dare to use anything but a camera to shoot it. A US Navy carrier strike group is an offensive and defensive force made up of an aircraft carrier and its baddest buddies, a combination of Ticonderoga cruisers, Arleigh Burke destroyers and fast attack submarines, plus other logistics and supply ships. The primary offensive firepower within the carrier strike group is of course provided by the carrier's air wing, which is primarily made up of F/A-18 Super Hornets. Starting in 2021, F-35C squadrons have also been joining the Super Hornets on these missions. These aircraft can be catapulted from the carrier, then fly 1,000 miles or more to strike the enemy. The strike capabilities provided by the 40 to 50 fighter jets aboard a single American supercarrier is only slightly less than what the Canadian or Finnish Air Force currently provides. But the carrier air wing is not just an offensive force. The Super Hornets also make up the first layer of air defenses for a carrier strike group. Several fighters are kept on combat air patrol, or CAP, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, patrolling the sea hundreds of miles away from the task force. The F/A-18E costs $21,000 per flight hour. The F-35C costs even more, almost double that, at $44,000 per flight hour. And that's without shooting any missiles. If the CAP spots an approaching aircraft on a threatening flight profile, they would intercept the enemy aircraft or any missiles that it may have launched. If the target is beyond visual range, the AIM 120 with a price tag of about $1 million would be the weapon of choice. But if the target is in short range, the AIM 9 Sidewinder will be more appropriate. The Sidewinder missile costs less than half as much as the AIM 120 and is quite an old technology. Having been developed more than 70 years ago, the Sidewinder is the world's first infrared homing air-to-air guided missile. It's of course been upgraded since, but it hasn't been replaced. Remember the Chinese spy balloon back in 2023? It was a Sidewinder that brought it down. However, if an anti-ship missile somehow gets past the Super Hornets, the Arleigh Burke destroyers and other ships in the carrier strike group are in charge of defending the aircraft carrier. And to do so, they use a multi-layered defense strategy. The first ship-layer defense is provided by the vertical launch system, or VLS cells, on Ticonderoga cruisers and Arleigh Burke destroyers. These cells are preloaded with a variety of missiles, anything from short-range SM-2 missiles, which is the Navy's go-to solution to defend against drones, airplanes, and cruise missiles, to SM-3s, which can intercept ballistic missiles in space. But these missiles aren't cheap, and defending against a swarm of incoming drones using SM-2s can cost an arm and a leg. For example, over a 15-month period starting November 2023, the Navy fired over 200 missiles, including SM-2, SM-3, SM-6, and evolved Sea Sparrow missiles, to defeat 380 Houthi attack drones and ballistic and cruise missiles, targeting U.S. naval and merchant ships. The SM-2 costs $2.1 million apiece. They fired 120 of those alone, which would have cost the Navy $250 million. The SM-3 missiles are even more expensive, ranging in price from $9 million to $27 million each, depending on the variant. To change this cost-benefit equation, some are advocating for directed energy systems against unmanned systems.
I think we all along knew directed energy, where a drop of fuel becomes a weapon, is a way to go, and we have to continue to pursue that.
Over the past decade, these systems have indeed been tested on U.S. Navy warships. These laser weapons hit the target near instantly, at the speed of light. You don't run out of ammo as long as the ship has power, and cost about $1 per shot. They are perfect to target drones. The only thing is, laser beams can be deflected. So if there is heavy rain, the Navy may be forced to fire a multi-million-dollar missile to hit a cheap drone. But these missile interceptors are not 100% guaranteed, so other defense measures are needed. Electronic countermeasures and decoys can confuse the incoming threat. Each VLS cell can also be packed with 4 evolved Sea Sparrow missiles for medium-range targets. If all that fails and the missile gets within a mile or less from the ship, close-in weapon systems, or CIWS, is the last line of defense, and it works against surface threats too. The idea with CIWS isn't to bring down the missile with a single bullet, but to create a dense cloud of tungsten that the missile can't pass through without being shredded. To build this wall of metal, the CIWS can fire 75 tungsten or depleted uranium rounds per second. When the threat is that close to the ship, there's no time for human reaction, which is why CIWS is fully autonomous, from detection to destruction. At this point, the aircraft carrier might be doing some wild maneuvers too, as a last resort. Thankfully, the gyro stabilization allows CIWS to stay on target, even during rolls and sharp turns. Every ship in the fleet has a Snoopy on board. When an unknown aircraft, ship, or object that may be a potential threat or intelligence target gets too close to the ship, they call in the ship's nautical or otherwise photographic interpretation and examination team, or Snoopy for short. They get called like this: "Away the Snoopy team! Away the Snoopy team! Surface contact! Port side!" The team members must rush to the deck and get into position in less than 5 minutes. These sailors determine the type of vessel, weapons on board, speed, size, direction of travel, any flags, and whether the contact is friendly or not. The goal is to collect intelligence and monitor the situation, then document their findings and send it to the ship's intelligence officer. That's all great, but in reality, the single biggest threat to aircraft carriers is a blow from below, and the US Navy knows it. That's why a few years back, they rented a submarine from Sweden. In 2004, the Swedish government received a request from the United States of America to lease Gotland, a Swedish-flagged submarine, and its personnel for 1 year. The US Navy wanted to use Gotland in anti-submarine warfare exercises, and the results were unexpected. Gotland managed to penetrate the defensive measures of Carrier Strike Group 7 undetected, and snapped several pictures of USS Ronald Reagan during an exercise in the Pacific Ocean. In real life, this was equivalent to sinking the aircraft carrier with torpedoes. For this reason, one of the most important roles of destroyers in a carrier strike group is ASW, short for Anti-Submarine Warfare. See that massive bulge in the bow of the destroyer? That's the SQS-53 low-frequency sonar. It can work in passive mode, where it simply listens for any submarine noises, or in active mode, where it sends out signals and listens for any echoes. Arleigh Burke destroyers may also be equipped with towed array sonars, which can be reeled out into the water to detect submarines. The advantage of towed sonar is its adjustable depth, and that it can provide a larger detection area. Upon detecting a submarine, the destroyer could launch Mark 54 torpedoes via the ship's torpedo tubes. These torpedoes have a range of less than 6 miles. An alternative is to launch the Mark 54 torpedo using a missile from a VLS cell. This allows the ship to target a submarine without having to get too close to it. Once the missile is within range, the torpedo would get parachuted down into the water and home in on the submarine. There are also ASW helicopters on board the destroyers, which can go farther out to detect enemy submarines and deploy that same torpedo. I should note that the first aircraft catapulted from an aircraft carrier is almost always the E-2D Advanced Hawkeye. Cruising at 30,000 feet, its massive 24-foot rotating radome scans hundreds of miles in every direction, detecting and tracking targets more than 300 nautical miles away. Any threat it spots can be instantly shared with patrolling FA-18s or the ships in the strike group, meaning that even if a destroyer can't directly see a distant threat, the Hawkeye becomes its eye, enabling it to engage the target. In fact, all elements of a carrier strike group, from fighter jets to Aegis destroyers, are wired into one seamless web of overlapping sensors, functioning like a single enormous combat brain. But let's say all these layers of support fail. Can the aircraft carrier actually be sunk? No ship is unsinkable. During World War II, 5 American aircraft carriers were sunk by Japan. That said, since World War II, no American supercarriers have been sunk in combat. And that can be in part attributed to the improvements in ship design, as well as the defensive layers provided by the ships in the carrier strike group. In reality, there is no need for the enemy to sink the aircraft carrier. Just some serious damage to the flight deck or disabling the propellers so that the ship cannot move fast enough could be sufficient to hinder flight deck operations. Because remember, an aircraft carrier that cannot launch or recover aircraft is just a really expensive airport floating in the ocean.